This is the hour of grace.
God has nailed every curse on the cross for you. The snare is broken.
Hour of Grace with Pastor Sonny O. Wogu. Tune in for more expository, reviving, and refreshing word from the throne of grace. Hour of Grace, transforming lives.
This is the hour of grace.
The power of giving thanks. The power of giving thanks. And I will take my text from the book of Mark, chapter 8. Mark, chapter 8, verse 1 to 9. Mark 8, 1 to 9. In those days, the multitude, being very great and having nothing to eat, Jesus called his disciples to him and said to them, I feel compassion for the crowd. I feel compassion for the crowd. I want us to notice the word compassion. They have been with me now for 3 days and have nothing left to eat. If I send them away to their homes hungry, they will faint from exhaustion on the road because some of them have come a long way. His disciples replied to him, where will anyone be able to find enough bread here in this isolated place, in this wilderness, to feed these people? He asked them, how many loaves of bread do you have? They said, 7. He directed the people to sit down on the ground, and taking the 7 loaves, he gave thanks and broke them and repeatedly gave them to his disciples to set before them, and they served the crowd. They also had a few small fish, and when Jesus had blessed them and given thanks, he ordered these fish to be set before them as well. And the people ate and were satisfied, and they picked up 7 large baskets full of the broken pieces that were left over. About 4,000 men were there, besides women and children, and he sent them away. The power of giving thanks, the power of giving thanks. Though we may not know it, but it is true that the power of giving thanks cannot be overemphasized. The importance of the power of giving thanks cannot be overemphasized. It is something we often neglect, maybe out of ignorance or carelessness. We may not appreciate that there is power in giving thanks. Unfortunately, we do exactly the opposite. We exhibit so much ingratitude. Instead of giving thanks, we take things for granted. We look down on the things God has given to us. We compare ourselves to others. We complain, we murmur. There is power in thanking God. Thanking God is a complete prayer on its own. That's the mistake people make. They think until they read out their prayer requests, they've not prayed. Thanking God is a complete prayer on its own. The text we have just read is a very familiar scripture, but we are reading it so that we can draw lessons from it, bearing in mind that in the book of 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, the word of God makes it clear that all scripture has been given to us for learning and instruction. So we are to learn from this scripture even now. I want you to see it in that light. In the text we read, the author and finisher of our faith, Jesus Christ, showed us the power of giving thanks. That's a very classical example. We saw that in that text, while the disciples looked down on the few loaves and fishes they had, Jesus asked for those elements. Jesus took the few loaves and fishes, and all he did was to give thanks to the Father. That was all the prayer he did. He didn't go into a long intercession. He just gave thanks to the Father and set those few loaves and fishes before the people, and they were fed, they were satisfied, and had so much remaining. Jesus commanded them to sit down because he knew he was going to give them a feast. They were standing. He said, sit down. You are going to eat and eat to your satisfaction. And the Bible says they ate to their satisfaction and had so much remaining. And what was the prayer? Thanks, giving thanks. He just took and gave thanks to the Father and began to feed the people. One of the outstanding miracles that Jesus performed was raising Lazarus from the dead. You remember? That miracle was outstanding because Lazarus was allowed to be in the grave for how many days? For 4 days. By then, decomposition will have set in. Even the sister refused that the tomb should be opened. He said, by now, he will be stinking. So no one was left in doubt that the man was gone. If you look at your Bible, you will see the kind of prayer that Jesus prayed. Jesus simply gave thanks to his Father. He didn't do anything more than thanking his Father. And then he called Lazarus to comfort. That was it. So the importance of giving thanks cannot be overemphasized. If you look at the book of John chapter 11, verse 41 to 44, you will see exactly what I'm talking about. John chapter 11, verse 41 to 44. In that verse 41, then they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was lying. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I thank you that you have heard me. I'm only doing this because of the people around, so that they will know that you sent me. Lazarus came forth, and Lazarus came forth. So the prayer was just to thank God for what God had already done. So you could see that that was the pattern of Jesus. So thanking God is a complete prayer on its own, because it shows understanding that God has already given you the power. God has already given you the provision. You thank him and you take what he has given to you. So, giving thanks is a complete prayer. I don't want you to ever forget that. Because many times we think until we have mentioned all the prayer list that we have not prayed. No, that is not correct. So, Jesus is our perfect example. And if he has done this, it is so that we can learn from him. Today, we look down on the things we have. We just look at some of the things we look down on and refuse to appreciate and thank God for. And that is why we are having so much problems. Let's start with our God. From our utterances, the utterances we make, we always make our God look like the God of grasshoppers, like the children of Israel did in Numbers chapter 13, verse 33. Numbers 13:33. In Numbers 13:33, The Bible stated, there we saw the giants, the descendants of Anak, came from the giants. And we are like grasshoppers in our own sight, and so we were in their sight. This was the utterances that the children of Israel made concerning themselves and their God. They compared their God to the God of grasshoppers. That was exactly what they did. You ought to thank God for adopting you as his child. When you thank God for adopting you, the Almighty God adopting you as his child, it shows understanding. When you begin to thank God, how many times have we thanked God for making us his children? The Almighty God, the all-sufficient God, making us his children, making us his heir, giving us his inheritance. When you begin to thank God for that, it makes a lot of difference. So that is how we should go about it. We look down on ourselves. We don't thank God for who we are. We have such insecurity about ourselves, low esteem about ourselves, lack of confidence. I'm not talking about being proud and haughty, but I'm talking about knowing who you are in the Lord, knowing who God has made you to be. There is a great difference. So we must thank God for ourselves. In the book of Psalm 139, verse 14, Psalm 139, verse 14, the Bible said there, "For I am fearfully and wonderfully made." Made by God. Fearfully and wonderfully made by God. Unfortunately, we have insecurities because of our past experiences. We allow it to weigh us down instead of shoving behind what is past and moving forward. Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, had such insecurity about himself because of, you know, what circumstance threw at him. He became lame. He was not lame at birth, but somehow his maid was trying to run when there was, you know, commotion about the Philistines routing the soldiers of Israel. The very day that Saul and his sons, including the father of Mephibosheth, Jonathan, died. So there was commotion. People were running. The maid carried him and tried to run, and he fell. And in the process became lame. Over time, Mephibosheth lost self-confidence. Mephibosheth could not pick the bits and pieces to move on in life. So we saw that in 2 Samuel chapter 9, particularly in verse 8, Mephibosheth called himself a dead dog. A dead dog. What a horrible description for one to give to himself. A dead dog. That showed you the insecurity he had about himself. This was someone that was fearfully and wonderfully made. That he had a challenge in his life did not remove the fact. Look, if God says you're fearfully and wonderfully made, that is the truth. Every circumstance of life may be a fact as you look at them, but they can't supersede the truth. The truth remains superior to the fact. That is why you see some people, in spite of their challenges, they recognize that they were fearfully and wonderfully made. They will rise to the occasion, and you'll see them doing things that you will never expect such people will do, because they activated the truth about themselves. Let me tell you, no matter who you are now, no matter what life is throwing at you, if you will appreciate who you are based on the word of God, that you are fearfully and wonderfully made, that God is your father, that God is your helper, I can assure you, you will overcome every challenge that the devil will throw at you. Thank God for who you are. We fail to do that. Another thing we fail to do is to thank God for our relationships. Our relationships. Relationship between spouses. Relationship in the family, father and the children, mother and the children, and siblings, friends. We fail to thank God for these relationships. And by so doing, we fail to take advantage of these relationships. That is not correct. In the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 4, Ecclesiastes chapter 4, if you read from verse 9 to 10, you will see what God says about two are better than one. Two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. For woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him. Two are better than one. But you hear so many people, when they get married, they say, hey, my trouble has started. That since I got married, that was when my... No, you are lying. You are repeating the lie the devil has sold to you. Do you know some young men are refusing to marry because they think that marriage will add to their problems? You hear young men say, me, I've not eaten. How much more to go and carry another woman to go and feed? You see, you are walking in ignorance. The word of God, which is the truth, says two are better than one. He said, when one falls, the other one will lift him. Thank God for your relationship. Thank God for your parents. Don't look down on your parents. Don't think you know better than they. If you are more educated than your parents, you are not wiser than your parents. Your academic credential does not give you the right to look down on your parents. We must appreciate the relationship that God has given to us. Thank God for what you have. Some are there wishing that they are children of some other parents. Who are you to decide where you should come from? Some are there dreaming, oh, how I wish I came from another country and not from the country where God has put me. Who are you, they claim, to decide to the potter how you should be made and fashioned? Let me tell you, don't insult the wisdom of God. Thank God for who you are. Thank God for where you are. It is where you are that God will bless you. So we must not despise our relationships. Another thing we fail to thank God for is our work, our ministry. We find faults, you complain about your salary, you complain about the benefits you get, but you've not thanked God that you at least you have a work. And there are some that don't have at all. You need to thank God for what he has given to you. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 23, the Bible says, and whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men. Whatever you do, are you sweeping? Sweep it heartily. Sweep it with commitment. Sweep it with faithfulness. As unto the Lord. Don't sweep it and say, hey, after all, how much are they paying me here? After all, what am I going home with? No, that is a wrong attitude. Thank God for what you have. Are you in ministry? Don't despise your ministry. Steer the gifts. Thank God for the gift that God has given to you. Begin to use them. Many of us always run from pillar to post, looking for people to pray for us when we can be raising the dead. And we don't even know it. Some of you looking at me right now, you may have such powerful gifts of healing and, you know, performing of miracles that you have never steered. And if they talk to you now, do you know that you can do this? You say, me? You will call yourself maybe the type of name Mephibosheth called himself. You say, me? I'm a nobody. I cannot. Who told you that? Thank God for the divine provision that he has given to us. So many things we take for granted. I don't think there is any day that we have just at the end of the day say, Father, thank you that today you gave me enough oxygen that sustained my life. Does anyone pray such a prayer? No. But now that there is COVID-19 and you see people panting for breath in the hospital and they're supplying them oxygen, we have suddenly realized that oxygen is an important thing. But we breathe in oxygen every day, free of charge, given by God. And we take it for granted. Thank God for keeping you alive. Thank God for making you healthy. Thank God for so many things, for his divine provisions. That is the right way to go. In Psalm 48 verse 9, we have thought, O God, on your loving kindness. In the midst of your temple, we have thought. You sit down and think. Think of God's loving kindness. It's not something you just take for granted and you gloss over. Sometimes just sit down and begin to think of God's tender mercies. The songwriter say, if you count your blessings, name them one by one, it will surprise you what the Lord has done for you. Go to that extent. Sit down. Count your blessings one by one. You'll be surprised. Don't allow the devil always to give you negative thoughts. Praise the Lord. We should thank God for our talents and opportunities. The opportunities God has given to us, the talents he has given to us, the platforms. When you do that, you will discover that those platforms will get bigger. They will become more productive. When you are working with people that are unbelievers, that is an opportunity to reach out to them. Don't complain, in this place, unbelievers. No, thank God that you have an opportunity to reach out to unbelievers. You enter an estate, you are the only believer there. Everybody is an unbeliever. Thank God for that opportunity. Father, thank you for bringing light into this estate. Don't grumble. Don't complain. Don't pack your things and run away. Say, I can't stay here. Only unbelievers are here. Let me go to the estate where only Christians are staying. No, God knew why he brought you there. Thank God that God has brought you there. Do you know when you do that, your light will increase in intensity. Thank God for every opportunity that he gives you, including the opportunity, the opportunity of salvation. Don't take it for granted. You may be listening to me now. I want you to thank God because you have an opportunity, the opportunity of salvation. Don't say, I had this type of message last week. I had it last month. I had it last year. I have had it for years. No, you are taking things for granted. Thank God for this opportunity that he's giving to you. Let's look at the book of 2 Peter chapter 3 from verse 3 to 5. 2 Peter 3 to 5. Don't be a scoffer. Knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days, walking according to their own lust. That's the word of God. And saying, where is, you know, they'll be asking, you know, useless questions. Where is the promise of his coming? As if God is asleep. As if God will not come. They'll be mocking and asking such questions. You know, we've been hearing this thing. When our forefathers were alive, they said it, that they were telling them, Jesus is coming soon. Our grandfather came and said the same thing. Our father came and said the same thing. Now they're saying it, we will go, and they'll continue to say it. They will laugh. They'll be mocking. No, no, don't do that. Look at what the Bible said in verse 5 of that same scripture. For this they willingly forget, that by the word of God the heavens we are old, and the earth standing out of water and in the water. Let me tell you, you willingly forget that God has created these things, and as he has created them, that is the way they are. But one day they will all disappear, just like God has made them. And according to his word, it will come to pass. Don't be a scoffer. He said he will come like a thief in the night, when they are not expecting him. In the days of Noah, they were mocking like this. They will laugh at Noah. That Noah said, rain will fall and destroy the earth. That rain will, water will come and scatter the earth. This and, do you know, before the flood, what you had, dews will come from the ground and water the place and wet the place. They've never had rainfall, deluge, and all that. They've never had it. So what Noah was saying was like Greek to them. They never understood. Noah was building an ark, not by the seaside, but far removed from the sea. They were wondering, what a foolish man. How can you build an ark in the forest? How many people will you use to drag it to the sea? Because they know that axe, boat, ship can only be used in the sea. It didn't make sense to them, but Noah heard from God. And Noah continued to do what he did. Eventually, when the heavens were open, the earth, the bowels of the earth opened, the waters were coming from the ground, coming from the heavens, and it, everywhere, water, the whole thing now lifted the ark. You could imagine how desperate they were, running towards the ark, beating on. But do you know what? God had locked all the doors of the ark. Only Noah and his family and all the animals that were brought in were saved. The rest were wiped out. Before then, they were mocking at him. They were laughing at him. People are mocking today. People are laughing today. But a day will come, they will laugh no more. Please, don't be in that position. Don't take the salvation of God for granted. Accept it now that you have the opportunity. Don't take it for granted. Thank God for this opportunity. It is my prayer that you make a wise choice.
You are not born again? Say this prayer. Lord Jesus, come into my life. I accept you as my Lord and Savior. I believe in my heart that you died and rose from the dead to save me. Right with my mouth, I declare you Lord over my life. Thank you, Father, for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. If you want us to pray or counsel you, please call. You can visit us at the Redeemed Christian Church of God, Shepherd's Hill, 54 NTA Choba Road, Mboba, Port Harcourt. Thank you for watching.